Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. I'm your host, Nurse Rona, and I'm here each month to bring you information and inspiration about health and well-being. Now, if you're like me, you may find that you get easily distracted, at times impulsive, and say what you think. And if you're working at your desk, you regularly get up and down every 5 to 10 minutes. Just because. Many of you know someone with ADHD, attention deficit disorder, but even if you don't, today's show can help anyone learn to sharpen your memory and attention, strengthen your mental flexibility, or understand more about how to control impulsivity, and even stop interrupting people. We'll also talk about attention fatigue, which is not a neurobiological disorder, but is caused by an overstimulating environment and culture. Adults with ADHD often struggle to stay on task, get to work on time, and reduce the anxiety and frustration that can come with distractibility and restlessness. ADHD can be managed, and new skills can be developed to build a person's capacity to be successful at work, home, and in relationships. As a matter of fact, many highly successful entrepreneurs have ADHD, and they do well as long as there are other folks to help them kind of close the deal. So if you want to procrastinate now from finishing your project or shopping, keep listening to today's show. And if you have ADHD, you're probably multitasking anyway. If you miss any part of the show today, I will post it on my website at nurserona.com. Joining me in studio today is Phil Boissiere. He's a marriage and family therapist who has spent the last decade treating adults with ADHD in the high-pressured environment of Silicon Valley. On top of his clinical training, Phil has pursued advanced training in the assessment and treatment of ADHD from Massachusetts General Hospital and Harvard University. Phil co-founded Silicon Valley's premier adult ADHD clinic in partnership with two Stanford medical doctors, and he also founded the online resource for adults with ADHD called Beyond Focused. As a clinical expert, Phil has been featured on major media outlets such as PBS, ABC News, Good Morning America, and others. Phil Boissiere, welcome back to About Health.
Hi, Rona. I'm happy to be here.
Really good to see you. Thanks for coming out today.
No problem.
You know, your new book is called Thriving with Adult ADHD, Skills to Strengthen Executive Functioning. There's another part of the title. What is that?
Get focused and achieve your goals.
Get focused and
achieve
your goals.
Packing it all in there. We got it all in.
Yeah. So this book, I have to say, it was really helpful for me to read it. I found that I learned a lot of new things about the way my brain works, and I saw what I'm already doing and some things I can do differently. And I'm just curious why you decided to write this book at this time.
Well, I think most folks would notice probably right away if they have ADHD or if they've read other books about ADHD that I don't even think within the first page there's even an adequate definition of what ADHD is. I really, we decided to jump right in and help people with some core skills for managing the deficits in executive functioning that come along with ADHD, rather than, you know, kind of belaboring the point about what ADHD is and speaking endlessly about medication and things like this. We just jump right in and get to this idea of executive functions and helping people train their brain, really.
And so, because you've done a lot of other work online, and it seems like it's still really helpful for people. I like your book because it has real exercises. It's like a way for someone to take you along with them that's accessible. Mm-hmm. You know, people may not be able to come see you mm-hmm. in your private practice or come to any of your other trainings, but it's really a wonderful tool to have along for the ride.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
So let's talk a little bit about what ADHD looks like in adults. You know, back in the day, I worked a lot at Kaiser with kids with ADHD. And it was interesting when we would do the assessments, about 50% of the parents who were seeking treatments for their kids turned out that mm-hmm. they also had ADHD, often not diagnosed.
Oh,
and
yeah.
So there's a definite genetic component. Talk a little bit about what it looks like in adults.
Yeah, I think, you know, historically when people think about ADHD, they think about you know, maybe a kid they knew, maybe themselves, et cetera, that was having trouble sitting still, being impulsive, that type of thing. And the reality is for most adults with ADHD, the impulsivity tends to kind of wear off as the brain develops.
And the hyperactivity lower, right?
Yeah, it lowers down, exactly. So it really, the key areas are around completing tasks, being organized, showing up to things on time. It does also affect relationships through emotional regulation. And also the, you know, if you're trying to tackle a household and one member has ADHD, it's going to lead to some struggles. And so procrastination, inattention, disorganization, things like this are really the key symptoms related to ADHD in adults. And just to point out, it's evident when someone is trying to do these things and they're struggling, right? It's not about just, well, I'm not doing anything to be organized or I'm not even trying. If someone's trying to be organized and they're going at it and they're really struggling and they feel really bad about how things are turning out, well, then we might be talking about ADHD or some related condition.
So part of that, I remember in working with families, I'd often talk about impairment. That if you, you know, again, back to children, if you have a high energy child who's, you know, attention wanders and is distractible and is a little impulsive, but they're functioning well in the classroom, they're functioning well with friends, there would be no reason to put a label on that child, for instance. So a lot of it has to do with what you just said. Is the person struggling?
Yeah.
And is there impairment? And I think that's a really important piece. You know, a friend of mine once said to me that ADD is, instead of attention deficit disorder, he said it's attention directional dilemma. And I thought that was a really good way to talk about it, because it's not like there isn't attention. It's where we're going to put that attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, your quality of life is really affected by where and how you pay attention.
Yeah.
So if you just take that piece, you can imagine that your quality of life really gets affected if your attention is not directed in the right place or it's moving around.
Yeah. Well, let's talk for a minute before we open up the phone lines. And we will definitely open up the phone lines so you could call with your questions. We'll do that in a few minutes if you want to take down the number. It's 1-800-958-9008. That's 800-958-9008. Let's talk a little bit about what you call attention fatigue and how it looks like ADHD, but again, it's not a neurobiological disorder. It's more about our environment. And I know you've been pretty interested in that recently. Mm-hmm. So talk about that a little bit.
Yeah. So really what brought up the attention fatigue thing was that, you know, several years ago, I created a video series for adults with ADHD. And I kept getting emails and reviews and calls from people saying, hey, I don't have ADHD, but this really helped me. Or I gave this to a friend who doesn't have ADHD and it really helped them. And so that got me thinking about, okay, what's going on, right? That's leading so many folks that don't necessarily have a disorder to be struggling. And lo and behold, the answer was right there. You know, it's screen time. It's smartphones.
Time.
It's too much information coming in, right? Consuming it. You know, back in the day, I've been a fan of KPFA forever, right? So turn on KPFA, driving in the car, get to work, get out of the car, go into work. Well, now, you know, we might listen to a very information-rich podcast and some KPFA, then jump into work and switch to another screen, then switch to some emails, and it just taxes the brain.
Mm.
And that taxing of the attentional system really manifests as some of the worst symptoms of ADHD in adults. Impulsivity, impatience, emotional dysregulation, trouble completing tasks, distraction, decreased quality of life. I mean, all of the real kind of top symptoms with ADHD. So I've just recently launched Overcoming Attention Fatigue, which is another series that's just aimed at the general public. Because when we're driving down the street and we see a whole line of people in front of the muni station in San Francisco and every single person is staring at their phone first thing in the morning,
yeah,
they're already kicking it off.
Right. And it goes on through the night, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And I know so many people are struggling with this in relationship to their teens and teenagers. And it's really serious because it's not only what it's... doing because of the input. It's what we're missing out on as well. You know, and you list in your book, you list some symptoms, and you say things like feeling pressured, too much going on, sense of having zero downtime, depressive thoughts or anxious thoughts without merit, angry, impatient, edgy, headaches, insomnia, mm-hmm. tired eyes, compulsive checking of digital devices without control. So there's a way in which people's brains are deeply being affected by this as well.
Absolutely. You know, I had a client recently put it in a way that I thought was fantastic. Their teenage child, you know, keeps bringing their phone to bed. And they said, hey, you know, at night, this is the only downtime nowadays that your brain gets. You sleep. It's the only time your brain turns off and it recharges. If you're on your phone in the middle of the night, you're not going to get that, right? And we're all suffering from that. And, you know, I do a lot of couples work. And I've got couples coming in and their marriage or their relationship is really struggling. And for years, I never asked, but now I do. They're sitting next to each other in bed every night, staring at their phone. Staring at something, taxing their brains, not connecting, not having sex, not bonding, all this stuff. No wonder we're struggling.
Yeah, and I know a lot of parents who have really tried to set the limit of having all the devices docked in the kitchen mm-hmm. and no devices being able to. But if parents are taking their devices with them to bed, it's a little tricky. You know, because our kids are watching us.
Oh, absolutely.
And they're really doing what we're doing. So this attention fatigue, you're separating it out from ADHD, and yet there's a crossover.
Huge crossover.
And that's where a lot of people wonder if the diagnosis of ADHD has increased because of all the stimulation and the lack of going outside into nature and the lack of spending that kind of downtime where you just let your brain recharge.
Yeah. I mean, it's a big deal, right? So if we think about why has the diagnosis or the numbers of ADHD gone up? Well, let's just take pharma just to get that out of the way. Absolutely, right? So whenever there's moneyed interests, it's going to be pushing for more diagnoses, et cetera. That is a huge issue, and that's a real thing. But on a more positive, there's more awareness, right? So we have that. But if we look at everyone else, you talk about people not being out in nature. One of the ways in which I've structured my life is that in some days I run myself ragged so that I can get my kids early so that we can go play, so we can go to the beach, we can go for a hike, we can go out into nature. And we live in San Francisco. Think about how many people are in San Francisco. And regularly, we are the only people that we'll see.
Mm.
Where is everyone else? They've got to be indoors staring at a screen. The playgrounds are empty. If there are parents there, they're not usually on the playground. They're staring at their phone and their kid comes running over, right? I mean, this is where it's starting. So if parents are doing that, kids are doing that, they're growing up, it presents just like ADHD.
Yes.
And if you started using a smartphone when you were 6 years old, how's a doctor going to know any different if you come and report that you feel like you have ADHD?
Right. Yeah. And the diagnosis is always so tricky anyway, because a lot of it is subjective.
Mm-hmm.
And there is no gold standard for diagnosing. And I mean, I got diagnosed in my 40s with learning disabilities, which suddenly made so much sense, you know, mm-hmm. in terms of realizing how I had lived my life, not wondering why I couldn't do things that other people could do. And with that came some ADHD diagnosis as well. And for me, it just put pieces together of this puzzle of understanding myself, you know, but it was mild enough. It made sense to me. And yet I don't talk about it a lot here. I'm saying it on TV, on radio, because there are a lot of people who sort of dismiss that diagnosis as well. So what's that like for you in terms of working with the parents and the patients you work with?
Well, let's touch on that just for a sec, if we can, this idea of this kind of way in which many people struggle with the diagnosis of ADHD altogether. And I was actually at the top of the hour, I kind of wanted to jump in and interrupt you and say this because I think it's really important. For folks that don't have any attentional struggles or they don't have ADHD, it's a very, very foreign concept to think, well, just focus. Why can't you just focus? I don't understand how you couldn't focus. Just do the thing. Go over there. Do the thing. Get it done. Don't procrastinate, right? It's just very foreign because it's not something that people tend to experience without ADHD. But if you talk about something else, like depression, everyone's had loss. Everyone's felt down. Everyone can kind of empathize with what that's like. Anxiety, they've experienced it. All these kinds of things, right? But when it comes to ADHD, it tends to fall into this chasm of some people just can't get their head around it. And it leads to a lot of relational struggles.
You know, I remember when I taught a class for parents, I would say to them, you know, if your child was blind, you would never say, now, come on, just look at this. And or if your child was deaf, you'd never say, now, come on, listen to me. But when a child had trouble with focus and distractibility, parents would say, come on now, just pay attention. And so often with the sense of why can't you just do it? Mm-hmm. And I think there, you know, once parents in particular, but spouses and bosses and other people realize that this is a real thing, then there's some empathy and understanding of, oh, this is not being lazy. This is something mm-hmm. that's a real issue. I know a lot of people with ADHD have trouble with time. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm always early because I don't want to be late.
Yeah, yeah.
But I don't have a good sense of time. I don't have a good sense of how to manage my time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another key thing. I just want to open up the phones here. You're listening to About Health. I'm your host, Rona Renner, and I'm here talking today with Phil Boissiere. He's a marriage and family therapist who has spent the last decade treating adults with ADHD in Silicon Valley, and his new book is called Thriving with Adult ADHD, Skills to Strengthen Executive Functioning, Get Focused, and Achieve Your Goals. Let's take our first call now. We have Patrick with us from Oakland. You're on About Health, Patrick.
Good afternoon, you guys. Happy holidays.
Thank you so much. You too.
Hi, Pat. Thanks for calling in on Christmas Eve on a rainy day here in the East Bay.
this is a subject close to my heart, so I had to. I was diagnosed with ADHD late 40s, mm-hmm. and I was so grateful to have found the reason for my chaos in my whole life.
Mm-hmm. Yes. You
know, high-functioning, straight A's through most of all of high school and almost all of college. But the lingering, what's wrong with me, and the lingering trying to cover up forgetting or timelessness or the whole list that you guys are talking about.
Mm-hmm.
The question I have, and it's this tiresome realization, is that this thing doesn't go away.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. So your question is, does it go away?
No. I guess I'm stating it doesn't go away. I try to explain to my friends, like being colorblind. You know, I can't see blue, and it's always green. It's always going to be that way. It's just dealing with, you know, I have to have someone else put my clothes on or you know, color me. But with ADD, it's like I'm struggling after 10 years still.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm looking forward to your book. For sure, but I've read lots of books and enacted lots of things, and it's not something that just comes, just do this and you're solved.
Right. No. And I just want to say before we turn it over to Phil, I really appreciate what you said, because so many people, myself included, you know, very smart. You know, some people get A's. I didn't get A's, but I struggled a lot in school. But you could get through. But what's happening? What's going on underneath? People don't understand.
Absolutely.
How
the
hard.
Anxiety of about.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, I just stopped watching TV when I was in high school. And I never have had a TV again because of the distraction factor.
Uh huh.
And I didn't even know what it was. I just knew that if I had that television.
Yeah.
I'm not going to get my stuff done.
Well, let's hear what Phil has to say. And I just want to tell you, I'm 70 now, and it gets has gotten easier for me as I've had less that I have to do. There's some hope there with age. But Phil, why don't you respond to Patrick?
Yeah. So, Patrick, thanks for calling in again. You know, I think I don't necessarily hear a question in there, but I really just want to thank you for making that point, right? Because it is a lifelong struggle. Rona, I can't believe you're 70 years old. If you could see her, you wouldn't think she was 70 either. I'm shocked, but I need to figure out, you know, I don't know what you're doing to stay young, but you're doing something.
It's my ADHD.
There you go. Right. It's a benefit. It doesn't go away, and it is a daily struggle, and there's ebbs and flows. And, you know, Rona's point about life being busy really does make it worse. You know, people are overwhelmed and your brain is taxed and you're exhausted, you know, I think over the long haul, probably the absolute most important thing is consistency in sleep, diet, movement, above all else.
Right. Right?
There's 101 tips, tricks, and wonderful things you can do. But I even say this in the book, and I start right out with it, right, that it's just so important. Right. We come into the world as babies. We need consistency. We need sleep. We need movement. We need these things. And then somehow we think when we're, you know, 30 something years old that we don't need it anymore. And it just gets worse.
Yeah. Yeah. Patrick, thank you for calling. And also, I want to mention
consciousness to other people. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. And I just want to mention how many wonderful assets there are that we don't want to forget about either. You know, the way I can globally think about things, the way interact with people. Right. So remember to also notice the goodness that it brings for you as well. He's laughing. Okay, Patrick, let me take another call.
Thanks, Patrick.
Take care. But it's true, Phil. I mean, I don't want to say that. I don't want to dismiss the pain and the difficulty. But I think it's really important to also look at the way your brain works in a positive way as well.
Well, yeah. And there's a reason why, you know, if we think about adrenaline junkies, quote unquote, adrenaline junkies, if you look at like extreme sport athletes, the rate is about twice of ADHD is prevalent in about twice as many extreme sport adrenaline junkie type athletes than it is in the general public, because their brains are tuned in a way that they really can thrive under those kinds of conditions.
Yeah.
So wherever we see folks in careers and jobs that are, you know, high adrenaline, kind of lock you into the moment, they tend to shine. And I'd be curious, you know,
Michael Phelps,
if there's anyone else out there. Yeah. I mean, you're locked when you're swimming and you're competing like that.
And there's also a risk for people with ADHD because they do take risks. There's the risk taking part.
Oh, yeah.
Let's take another call. We have Alan with us from Berkeley. Alan, you're on About Health.
Oh, yes, Nurse Rona. I just wanted to understand how you can, you know, be places. Though I doubt you'd say you're always places early every single time. You know, is it mostly due to having a less crowded schedule than 10 or 20 years ago? Yeah, because that's been a struggle for me.
You know, it's interesting, Alan. I think because I'm a highly responsible person that I didn't like the anxiety of being late. And I recognized that I didn't have a good handle on how much time things would take me. So I think I really, in a way, made a decision, both consciously and also because of my moral compass, I guess, that I was just going to, you know, if I had a job and I had to be there at 1 p.m., I'd get there at 12. And I'd bring something to read in my car, and I would sit there and enjoy myself and relax. So that was my strategy. I don't know. Phil, how do other people deal with being late?
Well, I think, you know, some acceptance around the anxiety is really uncomfortable. For some people, it's not, but, you know, I'm like you. It's hard. I don't like to be late. Before coming here, my wife was like, you need to go. I can tell that you're starting to kind of bubble up. You need to get the car and go get there early. But if you want a kind of a tip and a trick there, Steve, is to rather than make the, Alan, I apologize, make the appointment time. Let's say you have an appointment at 2 o'clock. Don't make the appointment in your mind 2 o'clock. Make the appointment the time that you have to leave. So decide today what time you're going to have to leave tomorrow to get to that appointment, and make that an immovable time rather than, I can squeeze a few more minutes in. Oh, I can do a couple more things, because that's inevitably what's going to trip people up.
Is that what trips you up, Alan, is squeezing other things in?
Sometimes, yeah. But I hope you weren't insinuating that I'm not responsible, by
no,
or anything.
No.
Or not moral. I certainly hope you're not trying to do that.
Oh, no. See, what it is though I get so anxious about being late, whereas other people, it wouldn't bother them. But no, I don't imply that at all. I think people who are late regularly get stuck, and they get, yes. they're not on time, not because they don't care. And I think it's really important. I think this was in your book, Phil, is to tell people in your life who you care about, look, I'm not late because I don't care about you. I'm struggling because I have this problem. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely right. So that people understand where you're coming from.
Yeah. Thanks for your call, Alan.
Estimation. Thank you.
Thanks, okay. Alan.
Bye-bye. Let's talk with Steve now. You're on About Health, Steve. No, Steve's not there. Okay, let's try Catherine from Santa Cruz. You're on About Health.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, one second. I had a question, or I was wondering what your thoughts are on medication for ADHD and maybe, such as like Adderall or what is prescribed typically and alternatives. Methods of medicating or dealing with ADHD.
And is that something that you've had experience with, or you're just curious?
Curious.
Okay, good. Thank you for the question, Catherine. Phil, why don't you start, and then I'll add.
Yeah. First off, the medication piece, I'm not a doctor, but I did own a clinic with a couple of doctors, and so I've had plenty of experience being around medication. And if someone truly has ADHD, they've had an adequate assessment, and they're working with a doctor who knows what they're doing, medication can be absolutely critical for many people. There certainly are people that are prescribed that don't have ADHD, or they've cheated the system, or these different types of things. But if we just look at people with clearly defined ADHD, medication is extremely important. However, going back to something I had said earlier, you have to have the right gas in the tank, right? You have to sleep. You have to eat correctly. You have to move your body. Otherwise, the medications only have so much effect.
And you have to work on strategies,
mm-hmm.
too. My sense about it, too, I tried Ritalin at one point many, many, many years ago. I just wanted to see what it would be like to have it be different. And I was amazed how I could clean my spice rack and focus for an hour straight without doing anything else. It was mind blowing to see that I could do that. But I personally didn't like how it felt, and I decided that I didn't need it. But it was an interesting experience to compare what it was like on and off. I do know that a lot of people, do benefit. It's a question that you have to grapple with. There are people who use other forms of medicine, like herbs.
Mm-hmm.
I know someone wrote to me this morning about she uses something called Restores, which has a lot of vitamins. It has a lot of vitamin B, A, E, and glutamine. So if you're working with a naturopath or a homeopath, you can sometimes find those kinds of things that help you, going along also with the idea of eating well.
Mm-hmm.
But it shouldn't be something that's taboo. I think medication can really be helpful, even if it's for a short term. I know someone who used it only when the pressure was really high to get tests done and reading done, for graduate school. So everyone is individual, and there's no judgment there if someone decides to use medication. Thank you for your call. We're talking about ADHD in adults, and how there are, we'll get to some strategies about how you can work with your executive functioning.
Mm-hmm.
And I want
mm-hmm.
to talk about that. But let's take one more call here first. Let's see who we have. Who's next? I think it is Carmen. Carmen, you're on About Health.
Hi. So I have ADHD, and I had it as a child, and I thought it went away. Apparently it came up in my adulthood, and I had a really hard time with socializing. I feel that because, I do have ADHD, that, my brain doesn't work the same way as others, and it's hard to have a conversation where you don't go off on a million tangents, but at the same time, you know, having to repeat yourself as well, you know, I just ended a relationship because of it. I was wondering if there's any tips as far as trying to be better about communicating with other people or socializing with other people when you have it.
Thanks for your call, Carmen. And I want to, you know, you just brought up something that is so important, and I don't think it gets enough airtime. No pun intended, Rona. And that is some of the most distracting stimuli is that of emotion, right? And so when going to socialize, meet new people, be in different environments, that when emotions kick up, it can be extremely distracting, right? And so I just want to speak briefly about something that is kind of it really helps exemplify what's going on for folks with ADHD. So everyone has essentially these two pauses, right? The first pause is where we very quickly, we stop, we say, what's that stimulus? Okay, is it a noise? Is it a door closing? Is it somebody asking me a question? What is it, right? Then the second pause is, how do I respond to it, right? Do I close the door? Do I greet the person? What do I say? Right. And so for people with ADHD, those two pauses can be so small, it's almost like they don't exist. And so when people are using, you know, the main reasons why medications, specifically stimulant medications, tend to help is that they raise base levels of not only dopamine, but norepinephrine. And norepinephrine helps people isolate the signal from the noise. What is the topic we're talking about? What is the question that's being asked? Who's asking me the question? What am I feeling? These types of things, and really helps clarify that.
And so also you talk about taking a pause too, that one of the strategies in relationship too,
yeah.
I notice for me is if I'm starting to feel a lot of emotion, I start to do my deep breathing and just to kind of give myself a chance to calm down before I respond.
Yeah. So I think we can, you know, roll this idea of, you know, right on top of the question of pausing and taking a breath. You know, anyone can wait for you to take a slow, deep breath or two.
But it's me having to remember to take that breath.
Certainly.
That's the hard part,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Right. The other thing with relationships I want to say is, Carmen, it's important. I found that, you know, asking my husband to read the book, you know, Driven to Distraction, a long time ago by Dr. Hollowell, was really helpful for him because he understood something about me that helped him in relationship to me.
Yeah. You know, another thing, Carmen, that you can throw on there is the mnemonic wait. Why am I talking? I use that one all the time. And I didn't hear it until, you know, I didn't make it up and I didn't learn it until just probably a year ago. And it's just wonderful. Why am I talking? Okay. Why am I sharing this story? What's the point of what I'm trying to tell? Should I even be talking? Right. It really helps.
Was there
awesome.
Anything else, Carmen?
Yeah, I just, that was the one thing that I didn't understand until recently was that, you know, people with ADHD, we socialize differently, you know?
Yes.
And,
yes.
Yes. And I always had a hard time with like work environments of, why is no one talking to me? Why do people get annoyed when I talk? So it was
right. And how, and am I distracting everyone?
Yeah. So
That's
I appreciate
right.
that. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Carmen. Thanks so much. Yeah. Distractibility. What I noticed this week when I was reading your book, and I just want to tell people that Phil's book is Thriving with Adult ADHD. I was reading this and I realized when someone distracted me when I was writing, it took me quite a while to get back on track.
Oh, yeah.
If the doorbell rang, whatever the distraction was, you don't get right back on track and you lose a lot of time that way.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, you know, there's research that's been done on this about workplace productivity. And if you take, you know, kind of quote unquote normal people, I'm not totally sure what normal is anymore, but if someone interrupts you, you shift, it takes about a half an hour for people to reach the level of productivity that they were at before. And so people are now interrupted sometimes hundreds of times a day between email and chat and people contacting them, text, et cetera. So you can see what that does. For folks with ADHD, there's a compounding problem there, right? Which is I've been in a place of focus. I'm cruising along. I'm doing well. I'm interrupted. I shift. And now in this time between shifting back to what I was doing before, something else can jump in there.
Right. And that's why people really do have to turn their sounds off. When you're working and you want to get in the flow, you've got to turn off your dings and clear your desk and really make it so that you can have any help you can get to stay focused, because you lose so much productivity when you get distracted.
Yeah, some of the techniques that are in this book and the techniques that are in my Beyond Focused for Adult ADHD video series, I used those techniques to finish this book, to write this book. And one of the techniques was to isolate myself for hours at a time, you know, and to turn off all chat and to let people know, hey, I'm going dark.
Yeah.
You're not going to be able to reach me. Make sure that someone was with my kids. They were taken care of. They were safe. I didn't have to think about it.
I had my snack. I had my food.
Yeah. I say I only got up during those times to use the restroom or to eat a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. That was it.
Yeah.
Right, keep moving.
Let's take another call now. We have Adam waiting from Walnut Creek. Thanks for waiting, Adam.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call. This is something that I've thought about a lot for a long time. So I think that there's a lot of overdiagnosis of ADHD.
Yes.
And there are a lot of things in life that can be distracting, and you've been kind of touching on some of them. And I think anxiety is one of the main things. I think anxiety is way underdiagnosed in this world, and people sometimes, if they say they're depressed, it's really kind of the exhaustion from damping down the anxiety. And so I think that, you know, some of the things that you're discussing of slowing down, doing one thing at a time. The whole idea of multitasking, I think, is total, BS, because the human brain can't really do that.
Right.
And people kind of work under this assumption that I should be able to multitask, and if I can't, then there's something wrong with me.
Right.
And, you know, the term comes from computers, and they can only do it if there's more than one processor in the box. We get one. And so when we switch back and forth, we're different than computers, because if a computer only has one processor and we ask it to do more than one thing at a time, they don't lose data. We lose a lot of it. And so I think, you know, a lot of the stuff about mindfulness and just slowing down and dealing with the anxiety and the other feelings that come up is really key, because so many things can be distracting.
You know, Adam, you said so much that's right on. Are you a professional in this field of psychology?
I am.
Yeah,
I am. I'm a psychologist.
Yeah. Because, you know, in making diagnosis, whether it's with kids or adults, there's so many other things that it could be instead of ADHD. Mm-hmm. And also sometimes these things come together. We call it comorbidities, but they come together also. So it's very important I just want to say thank you for everything you said. Phil, you want to respond?
Yeah, thanks, Adam. You know, multitasking is not only a myth. I mean, we just can't do it. It's just switching back and forth very quickly. I think it's also, I think it really decreases people's quality of life. And if we just kind of keep this in the now, you know, before leaving to come over here, you know, it's Christmas Eve. I've got two small kids, the dog, there's a lot going on. I was feeling kind of keyed up. Right. And stressed and a bit anxious, even though it's just this wonderful time. As soon as I got in the car and I'm driving in the pouring rain, it was gone. Right. Because I wasn't multitasking anymore. I was driving and it was raining, which was keeping me safe. And I don't text when I drive and these types of things. Right. And all of a sudden my quality of life went up, and it just seems totally counterintuitive. But it's very real.
Yes. Thank you for all of that. Let's take another call. We have Greg with us from Palo Alto. Greg, you're on the air.
Hello. Thank you for this program, by the way. Before I forget, I want to offer one thing about that I've noticed, and I haven't really taken advantage of it, but I think that there's a real significance to this, and that is that I found that when I am soaking in hot water, or I take a lengthy, very hot shower, and my body can relax, that is one of the things that I do that really gets me into a completely different state. in terms of how I feel physically, because I've got an ongoing problem with PTSD, which sounds like in some ways it's on a, maybe on a continuum with what you're talking about with ADHD. And so I haven't been able to find ways, even though I'm a meditator, I do breathing exercises, of really being able to calm down my nervous system.
Yeah.
It seems to me that to me is the key, is trying to get into some kind of relaxed state. And I've had very mixed success in doing that.
Thank you for mentioning about the water. I think that's wonderful. I haven't thought about that for a while, but that's a really good example, Greg.
Well, it may be a bit of a tangent, but I think this is important information for people to have. So thank you, Greg. Yes, absolutely hot bath, going to calm you down, Epsom salts, get the magnesium in there, all this kind of thing. But a friend of mine, he's one of the top addiction specialists, and he has a facility here in the Bay Area. And you can't graduate his treatment program until you are taking 2 showers a day. It doesn't matter whether they're hot or cold, because the level of stimulation that your nervous system gets from that change in temperature, whether hot or cold, it just can't be understated. So again, a little bit of a tangent, but I thought it was a really important piece of information for people to have.
Also his comment about PTSD.
Oh yeah. Yeah, to help regulate the system. There's some really interesting hacks as far as how to get control of your or kick on your parasympathetic nervous system. You know, there's the 5-breath intake. A 2-count inhale, 5-count exhale, which helps. But there's also this very fascinating trick where if you lay down on the ground and you elevate your legs almost straight up in the air. Now, you have to be able physically to be able to do this, but just to lie flat on the ground and put your legs straight up in the air, and you do that for 5 minutes, and it has a way of kicking in the parasympathetic nervous system. And I've had people come down from panic attacks doing that right in front of me. It's a fascinating technique.
Yeah. Well, we're going to take some more calls, Greg, because we have people waiting. But I always appreciate hearing from you, and I wish you well.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Greg.
We're talking on About Health, about adult ADHD, and we're happy to take your call. We have Stan waiting next from Fresno. Hi, Stan.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon. Thanks for this subject. I'll be looking for your book. I'll probably repeat the program, too, on the after you. But everything you said, it clicks. But in my particular case, I had 2 questions. There's panic attacks, being around public, dealing with technology. I've got 20 years with a telephone company. I have to count cables up to 3,000 little conductors in different color groups, and it just drives me crazy. It's been like a bad marriage. I think I would have been better off doing some journalism or art or something. Now that I'm just about done, I'm going to get back to that. But now there's a new kind of thing that I've only noticed in the last couple of years. I'm 64. Is the emotional component, and the fact that my political activities, and I think it's true probably for you and anybody, that it takes a toll. But at a certain point, I seem to feel more emotionally engaged to the point where I can't control it in a sense, like just in a minute I'll be in tears. And I'm trying to give a presentation, go into some analysis or something, and I do a lot of speaking, and I have to count off on my fingers my next point or I'll forget it. But I've been able to survive, like they say, fake it till I make it. But at this point, the emotional component worries me or makes me wonder. But the other one is I have a 16-year-old son, and I see him doing this.
Yes.
Kind of the same thing. He has panic attacks.
Yes.
School is more demanding now. And, what do we do about this? I'm going to read your book, and I hope I get some pointers from that. But I've never been diagnosed with ADHD, but it just seems like everything seems to fit.
Thank you. And like we said before, there are a lot of things going on and we're overstimulated, all of us, all the time. It may be ADHD, it may be something else, but I'd like Phil for you to address the emotional piece that he's asking about.
Yeah. So the emotional piece is really challenging with ADHD, but I think it's a really important point for all of us right now, right? There's so much going on in the media. There's so much difficult kind of on the news and things happening on the global scale. It's really hard. And you mentioned your son, school and pressure. Something that I developed this for myself, ended up doing a TEDx talk on it, and it was not something that I developed for other people, but I ended up using it with, now I've used it with thousands of other people. But it's called the 3x3 method, and it takes 30 seconds. If you just Google my name, Phil Boissiere, and 30 seconds, the video will come right up. But essentially, you can do this while you're counting those wires, and it's a matter of naming an object in the physical environment and taking a deep breath at the same time. And you do that 3 times. So you might say, that is a conductor box, and you take a deep breath. That is a pencil, and you take a deep breath. That is a car, and you take a deep breath. And it really accomplishes 2 very important things. It pulls you back into the moment, kind of turns off that kind of brain that's thinking about too many things. And the breath calms the nervous system. And I've used it. What made me think of it actually, when you talked about counting those wires, I have a spinal surgeon who uses it. We're doing these very, very complicated procedures where he has to be very, very careful not to cut the wrong line, if you will, right? And he's using it during surgeries.
Mm-hmm.
I've got
to
a long
grounded.
Distance runner.
He's
yeah, to stay grounded,
grounded,
right? Because that emotional piece will pull you off. And it will just distract you and derail you. Your performance can go out the window.
And I also want to say, before we move on, you know, we all have to look at our lives. And now many of us are grieving over our planet, over the politics, over, you know, what's going on. And we all need to look and see, where do we have our sanctuaries, you know, and how do we help our kids not feel like they have to do everything, you know, don't have to worry about them getting in the best colleges. Mm. We don't want them to get all A's. They don't have to get all A's.
No.
You know, like, how do we make sure and build in going out into nature and hugging a redwood tree? Because that too will ground you for sure. So thank you so much for your call. I want to try and fit in Christine here. Christine from Petaluma, you're on About Health.
I just wanted to make a comment on, well, I had read somewhere not too long ago, if you have had, or if you're dyslexic, a lot of times ADHD or ADD go along with that.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times people with dyslexia
right.
also have that. And so thinking about myself, who am dyslexic or was more dyslexic as a child, and have learned over the years how to work with it. I definitely see the ADD
yes.
That I struggled with as a person, as a child and a kid growing up and a person. I had also heard something about how as adults we tend to be more, we struggle with organizational skills. So on that, with that being said, I also wanted to say what I do to, I don't do this sort of thing, by the way, I don't usually call and speak online or anything, so I'm a little nervous.
That's okay. I'm so glad you're calling, Christy.
Thank you. I'm so glad I tuned in. When I find myself needing to decompress, so to speak, I have done a couple different things. One thing that has really worked for me, or that I always think about, and even thinking about is nice and calming for me, is to, like, if I were to completely submerge myself in a pool or a lake, how that just not, and we can't always do that, obviously, but, you know, immediately your body temperature, you know, cools down.
Yes.
The sound is different. The feel, everything. It's like going somewhere else completely, and you're by yourself.
So you could even imagine that, even if you don't have the lake nearby, you can imagine doing that, and you can calm down from that. That's right.
Yeah.
And I just want to mention, I think it's somewhere about 40%, Phil, do you know, of people with like dyslexia also have ADD. There is some figure I remember from a long time ago.
I should be turning red right now because I should know those figures,
yeah, but
I just figures I struggle with figures, but it is pretty high.
Yeah.
It's pretty high. And one of the things that I've observed in talking to people who have any type of learning disorder related to reading or traditional dyslexia and ADHD is that the learning disorder often seems worse to them when the ADHD is worse, or if they're not medicated, right? Because it's a complex dance. It's really a symphony that your mind is conducting at any given moment.
And I think they're not separate. You know, we have these diagnoses, you know, dyslexia, learning disability, ADHD, and I found that I couldn't tell, is this my learning disability or is this my lack of attention and focus? And am I not paying attention because I have a learning disability and I'm frustrated? So I think they're very intertwined. And very connected in the neurotransmitters in our brain, for sure. Christine, thank you so much for calling in. I appreciate it.
All right. Thank you so much.
Okay. Bye-bye. We have Robert from Albany with us. You're on About Health, Robert. Oops. I'm not sure. Robert, are you there with us?
I'm here.
You're on the radio.
Okay. Hello. Thanks for the program. It was great.
And you need to shut your...
I'm here.
You actually have to shut your... Yeah, you have to shut your radio off. Because otherwise there's an echo. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Here I am now.
Hi, Robert.
Hi. Thanks for the program. And just... I wanted to ask about, and somebody else a little bit ago mentioned it, but the relationship between trauma and ADHD. So in my case, traumas, there's different kinds of trauma, obviously, in different ways and susceptibilities to that. In my case, child sexual abuse at the age of 4. I'm 70 now. And combat in Vietnam. At the age of 18. So just, you know, they're there. They don't go away. I mean, I've learned, and many of the things people are saying, I've been trying. Go ahead.
Okay. So your question is the relationship between ADHD and trauma, it sounds like. And
I think it's the functional relationship, yeah.
Yeah.
Functioning with those.
Yeah,
I actually, it's been harder since I retired. When I was an eighth grade teacher for 30 years, and it was like easy. I was just in the middle of that kind of activity.
Your brain, you were organized because of your teaching. You had a task and you had purpose, and it probably helped a lot too. You know, we only have a few minutes left, but I just want to say that we don't always know how our brain gets affected by trauma. We know, you know, with adverse childhood experiences, we know it affects our brain. We know it affects our body. We have diseases later on in life that have to do with our early childhood experiences. And again, I think it's sometimes hard to sort these things out. Phil, do you have any insight on that?
I think the easiest way to try and thank you for your bravery in sharing. I really appreciate that. And thank you for your service and your teaching and in Vietnam. Winnicott's, you know, quote from, way back in the day that there's only two things that can go wrong during childhood. Something's there that shouldn't be there, or something's not there that should be there. And if we kind of look at things through that lens, it's really easy to see how things can kind of get miswired, disorganized, et cetera, during childhood. And right now, you know what? We did not evolve to have smartphones in front of our faces when we are children. We did not evolve to have addictive games like Fortnite and the rest of it in front of us when we were kids. No wonder people are having trouble, right?
Yeah.
And so thank you so much for your call, and happy holidays.
And you know, thriving with adult ADHD does have a lot of examples of exercises and things that you can do to really help do some rewiring. And I'm sorry, we're almost out of time. We won't get to talk about a lot of those things. I just want to take one more call here because Steve's been waiting here for quite a while. Steve, can you keep it short? But we can take your call. You're on the air, Steve. Maybe we're having trouble. Are you there? No, I don't think so. I think I'm going to stop taking calls right now, even though there are people on the line, because in the next few minutes, there's so much. I just want to appreciate everyone who called. There's so many stories to tell, and I want to encourage people to talk to others in your life about your experience, about your story, about what's going on for you. I think if we can do more of that, then we all can get some kind of, I don't know, compassion, relief, knowledge. Mm-hmm. Information. But Phil, with everything that people have said and based on your work, what last pieces of information would you like to put out there about the way in which we can strengthen our executive functioning, we can strengthen our abilities?
So, you had said something, Rona, close to the top of the hour about your life being different now and, you know, not as busy.
Yeah.
I think we all really need to think about that. You know, we are bombarded by technologies that are essentially set up to steal our attention from us. And we're told lately, you know, that we're supposed to be busy. We're supposed to be answering emails at 10, 11 at night. You know what? We're not. And so look at how busy you are. See if you can manage that. And for me lately, I've been really, really working on this, and it's a challenge, but just to do one thing at a time. Hey kids, I'm back in the car out of the garage. I'm sorry I can't answer your question right now. If they keep going, they keep saying stuff, I've got to stop the car. I can only do one thing at a time. And in our world right now, it's important to do one thing at a time and settle into your experiences, settle into your moments, connect with people, make eye contact, smile, and by all means, get outside. Right. There's very clear research that time outside, and you don't have to hug a redwood tree. Like you said, I'm sure people were having conniption fits somewhere, with that.
You could just walk by the water.
Just
anywhere.
Be outside, yeah. You know, just put your feet in the sand. You know, you don't even have to move. Just be outside.
Yeah. And you mentioned your kids. And I think, again, there are many families where, you know, since ADHD has a genetic component and it does run in families, if you're feeling a lot of chaos in your family, just know that your kids are watching you and you are modeling for them. And so you might all need to learn together to do something like, you know, in my book, Is That Me Yelling? I talk about the ABCDEs of not yelling. Mm-hmm. You talk about stop signs, stop, think, observe, plan.
Yeah.
It's the kind of thing that if you see a lot of chaos going on in your own household, you can teach your kids about these things as well.
Well, I'm glad you brought up your book because, you know, Rona, your book is incredible. And the first two things in your ABCD, ask and breathe, you know, what am I feeling, asking yourself, and then taking a breath. That's you do those two things and you're gonna ground yourself. It's almost like the 3x3 method. It's great stuff.
Yeah. Well, Phil Boissiere, it's so wonderful to have you back
again. Thank you for having me here.
Cognitivetherapy.com, right?
I know I'm not hip enough to have that, but cognitivetherapysf.com is
okay.
My private
cognitivetherapysf.com.
Right.
And folks, you can go to my website at nurserona.com and you can get the show and information about Philip Boissiere. Thank you so much. And
yeah.
I'll be back next week. If you missed any part of the show, go to my website. Many thanks to our board operator, Michael Cohn. And James, I'm thinking of you on the other side of the wall. May you say be safe and strong and a Merry Christmas and a Happy Kwanzaa to all of you who celebrate. May we all take time this week to offer our gratitude to the earth and find ways to help people who are less fortunate. Let's keep our focus and attention on kindness and generosity. Thanks, Phil.
Thank you, and go KPFA.
Join KPFA for our next movie matinee as we screen the critically acclaimed Oscar-winning film, Thelma and Louise. This movie classic, starring Susan Sarandon, Gina Davis, Brad Pitt, and Harvey Keitel, offers thought-provoking commentary on freedom, assault, patriarchy, and friendship. The plot centers around two best friends who embark on a road trip that goes terribly awry, forcing them to make life-altering as well as life-affirming decisions.
Let's not get caught. What are you talking about? Let's keep going.
Join us on Saturday, December 29th at 3 p.m. at the New Parkway Theater in Oakland as we travel along with these two unlikely heroines on their road trip to empowerment, liberation, and the ultimate sacrifice. For ticket information, visit kpfa.org or thenewparkway.com. This is a KPFA benefit.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KF.